Friday, the president declared a national emergency. A lot of people do not understand what that actually put into motion. People think, okay, national emergency, he's just doing this to protect the public. But many executive orders kick in as soon as a national emergency is declared, such as Executive Order 10995, which provides for the government to take over all communication and media. Executive Order 10977 provides for the government to take over all power, gas, fuel, and minerals. Executive Order 10988 provides for the takeover of all food resources and farms. Executive Order 10999 provides for the government to take over all modes of transportation, trains, airports, highways, roads, everything. Seaports as well. Executive Order 11000 mobilizes, provides for the government to mobilize people into work brigades under government supervision. Executive Order 11001 provides for the government to take over all health, education, and welfare functions. Executive Order 11002 designates the Postmaster General to operate a national registration for all persons. Executive Order 11003 takes over, provides for the government to take over all airports and aircraft. Executive Order 11001 provides for the government housing and financial authority to relocate communities and designate areas to be abandoned and designate new locations to move populations. Executive Order 11005 provides for the government to take over all railroads, all inland waterways, and storage facilities. And Executive Order 11490, signed in by Jimmy Carter on July 20th, 1979, wraps all those up into one ball and provides for the, get this, folks, when all that happens, when the commander-in-chief declares a national emergency, it puts all operations, all these things, under the purview of the FEMA director. Did you know that, folks? Now, I haven't found an executive order that rescinds all that. So, all is needed is for a national emergency to take place, and the director of FEMA now can execute any of those executive orders. The executive branch, basically, by declaring a national emergency, transfers all those powers over to FEMA. But it becomes very dangerous in a crisis scenario of this magnitude. And it's a good thing, or we're at least being told, that the president tested negative for coronavirus, which is a good thing. So if he were to die, it would get pretty choppy up there, because the more I see Pence and his little beady eyes and his white hair, he freaks me out a little bit. Let's get back, because we need, with all that, we need to get back to making sure you all are prepared for this, just in case it comes. I'm not saying that it's going to go completely south, but it doesn't look good. So I think it's time for all of America to start preparing themselves for the worst. The president declared on Saturday that they're preparing for the worst. And I think the smart people out there have been on top of this. And my listeners, you know you're the smart people out there yourselves. You've been listening all along. And you've done your homework. You've done your prepping. I'm giving you more ideas right now on what you can do to keep you and your family safe. And that's another thing, ladies and gentlemen. During this whole thing, there's going to be a lot of hardship placed on families because they're not used to just being confined to their house. Because they're practically, and I've talked about it in an article I did on the website on Saturday. It's called COVID-19, the perfect Hegelian storm. Now, let me begin, folks, by saying I'm in no way diminishing the ongoing threat of COVID-19. It represents to the nation and to the world a dangerous threat. And it's going to be difficult to mitigate the effects of that are going to be coming to our health system, our economy, the supermarkets, and our overall welfare. But for weeks, you have been hearing me prepare you, my listeners, for this looming disaster of unprecedented proportions. Notwithstanding, ladies and gentlemen, the virus is the least of my concerns. However, the virus is the central problem at the heart of everything. Its appearance has sparked increasingly abnormal behavior in our everyday lives. The reaction to the crisis has been broad and swift. Sporting events, public education, business meetings, family gatherings are all canceled or postponed. Yet, according to the experts, who are merely agents of the government and the corporate elites, all think those measures are still not good enough to contain this latest kaiju. So far, the only solution is to divide us up even further than we already are. To be afraid of even your loved ones for the fear that the boogie-woogie virus is going to attack you. Oh, forgive me. They want us to wash our hands as well. Another solution to the media-driven super hype madness are those new drive-up tests. How convenient, don't you think, ladies and gentlemen? How convenient for the government. Anyone who has a little sniffle can drive up like they're going to Tim Hortons for a French vanilla latte. And of course, you don't have to give your contact information to Timmy Ho's when you go there, but, well, here you're going to have to give them your contact information so that they can track you down to if you have it. So the overall solution so far is to stay home unless you're feeling sick. Then go out to your local drive-thru hot zone to be tested by them. It seems incredibly cockeyed, ladies and gentlemen, and backwards to me. But what the hell do I know, right? I've only been talking about this for multiple weeks, for at least 2 months. It's been the largest news item that has dominated the show. Now we have another looming factor, is the population that will still be gallivanting around the country. Although it is true that employees from many companies are being told to work from home, many others are critical to the overall operation of business. Those people will be exposed until a more drastic solution is enacted. Also, and possibly more troubling, are the people who will resist the recommendations of the experts. Those who continue to defy the self-quarantine that is being strongly suggested. Now, how will they deal with those people? But, you know, I'm sure they have a solution at the ready for that reaction as well. Ladies and gentlemen, we're in unprecedented waters. In times of great crisis, we should heed the words of Mr. Rahm Emanuel. You never want a serious crisis to go to waste. It's an opportunity to do things that you think you could not have done before. Ladies and gentlemen, all I can say is stay safe, folks, because we're into some incredibly fascinating, interesting, historical times when you look at it. If the United States shuts down, if we are watching, like I told you folks weeks ago, when we did the math on when China supposedly first got it and how long it took before they had to come in and quarantine people. And let's talk about that to all the naysayers out there who are not taking this so seriously. It's just a bug, right? They don't quarantine areas for just a bug. Just saying, ladies and gentlemen. Not before. This would be the first time. And then the ones touting the Chinese numbers. Let me bring one thing clear, ladies and gentlemen. They rounded up a whole... There's plenty of videos on this. They've rounded up a whole lot of people. Maybe they didn't have coronavirus. And maybe that's why they're not in those numbers. They were potential coronavirus victims. And now they're gone bye-bye. So those wouldn't actually be totaled in the numbers. Now, would they, ladies and gentlemen? If they weren't affected yet, but they were in so association with them, and now they're gone, they went bye-bye, disappeared. They wouldn't be in the official numbers of coronavirus, would they? Just something for you to think about as we head on over to break. We'll be right back, folks. More coming, so much more. We're loaded. Stay tuned.